Our findings relate to the role of type 1 interferon signaling in dendritic cell dysfunction during blood stage malaria. Type 1 interferons are a family of closely related cytokines discovered in the 1960s for their potential to induce a potent antiviral state in cells. Since then, of course, type 1 interferons have been shown to regulate immune responses in a number of clinical and experimental settings. In malaria patients, it is clear now that type 1 interferon responses do occur. Moreover, polymorphisms in the essential gene for receiving type 1 interferon signals, the IFNAR1 or IFNAR1 receptor, contribute to the outcome in malaria infections. However, there is relatively little understanding in terms of what type 1 interferon responses actually do during plasmodium infection. In addition, while the phenomenon of dendritic cell paralysis is known in malaria, the molecular mechanisms underlying this process have not been well characterized. To identify causal roles for type 1 interferons during malaria infection, we and others have previously used mice that are genetically deficient for the IFNAR1 receptor. Using this tool, we found that mice are much better protected from malaria parasites and the disease that ensues in these mice. In this paper, we now extend this work to show that specific removal of the IFNAR1 receptor on conventional dendritic cells by using a CD11C Cre recombinase IFNAR1 flox system results in substantially improved CD4 positive Th1 responses and results in protection from lethal malaria infection. Next, given the existence of at least two major subsets of conventional DCs in mouse spleens, we next determined whether these subsets were differentially affected by an inability to receive type 1 interferon signals. We employed a number of different techniques, including mixed bone marrow chimeric mice using wild type and IFNAR1 knockout bone marrow, as well as the Cre-LOXP system that I've already mentioned, in addition to flow cytometric cell sorting of DC subsets to show that CD8 negative DCs retained the capacity to phagocytose in vivo. They expressed reduced levels of the immune suppressive cytokine IL-10 at the mRNA level and changed their expression of various costimulatory molecules on their cell surface, including CD86, CD80, and PDL2. This resulted in an increased capacity for CD8 negative CDCs to prime Th1 cells from naive CD4 T cells ex vivo when type 1 interferon signals were deprived in vivo. Importantly, most of these phenomena were not observed in CD8 positive DCs, suggesting preferential immune suppression of one DC subset over another by type 1 interferon signaling. Next, to allow us to focus on the CD8 negative DC population, we employed a transgenic mouse system, the Langerin DTR mouse. In this mouse, administration of diphtheria toxin removes many of the CD8 positive DCs, allowing us to study the impact of type 1 interferon blockade on the remaining CD8 negative DCs. Once again, type 1 interferon blockade in these mice resulted in boosting of the Th1 response, and most importantly, malaria parasites were controlled better both in the bloodstream and in the whole bodies of these mice. Finally, we were able to show that not only did conventional DCs respond to type 1 interferon signals, but in addition, this process was required for an optimal systemic type 1 interferon burst. And we also showed that CD8 negative DC may indeed be a potent source of type 1 interferon cytokines themselves. In terms of the significance of our findings, it's been known for several years that dendritic cell paralysis and immune suppression are a common feature of blood stage malaria. However, molecular mechanisms explaining these phenomena have been sparse. Our paper provides a single molecular explanation for both dendritic cell paralysis and immune suppression during blood stage plasmodium infection. One final point I'd like to make is that there is increasing evidence that type 1 interferon signaling can support unwanted CD8 T cell immune pathology during experimental malaria, although it is important to note that this has not been extensively studied in human malaria yet. Nevertheless, it raises an interesting scenario in which type 1 interferon blockade could potentially simultaneously drive two favourable outcomes. Firstly, the restoration and improvement in function of CD8 negative CDCs, as we have already discussed, but also the impairment of unwanted CTL-mediated immune pathology. Therefore, we propose that type 1 interferon blockade during blood stage malaria, either in the context of immune therapy or perhaps during whole organism-based vaccination, could provide a much-needed strategy for boosting antimalarial immunity in a safe manner.